Welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we are going to discuss about Introduction to Optimality Theory, Part 2. In the previous module, we talked about the major components of OT, the lexicon, the generator, the evaluator, and the constraint set. We also talked about the architecture of OT and the working of OT. In this module, we are going to focus on the major tenet or the core of OT, which are the constraint set. We're going to talk about the two types of constraint, the markedness constraints and the faithfulness constraint. The markedness constraints are the well-formedness constraint and the faithfulness constraints are the identity constraints. We are going to discuss in depth about these constraints and their interaction among each other. Constraints are of central importance in optimality theory. All the constraints in OT are universal in nature, phonologically grounded, and of course, violable and freely rankable. Technically, grammars are considered to be the ranking of constraints which are violable by the output candidates. While the constraints are universal, their rankings deviate in different languages. Hence, the grammars do not differ in terms of the types of constraints that they present. There are four major components based on which OT works. These are lex, gen, eval, and con. Among them, con represents the constraints. In OT, constraints demand structural requirement that may either be satisfied or violated by any output form generated by gen. However, con is just not one category, but it consists of two types of constraint: markedness and faithfulness constraints. Markedness constraints are similar to the surface structure constraints of filters that were introduced in the studies of the 1970s, whereas faithfulness constraints are the identity constraints. Markedness constraints favor some specific linguistic structures over others. Hence, they are often in conflict with faithfulness constraints, which resist any sort of modification to the input structures. It is also possible to have a similar conflict among homogeneous constraints, like markedness constraint can also be in conflict with other markedness constraints, or faithfulness constraint can be in conflict with other faithfulness constraints. In OT, this conflict or interaction of the faithfulness and markedness constraints leads to the optimal candidate. Now, as we already discussed, that markedness constraints are the structural well-formedness constraints. So some of the typical markedness constraints are like no coda, then no nasal vowels, no coda which says that there should not be coda in a syllable or a word, the vowels must not be nasal, so we have a star V nasal, the star signs for no, vowels must not be nasal, then there should not be a oral vowel before a tautosyllabic nasal, that is within a syllable. If a vowel is followed by a nasal, that vowel must be a nasal vowel. Then we have that VOP which says that no obstruents must be voiced, and coda obstruents are voiceless, no voiced coda. Similarly, we have faithfulness constraints. Let us look at some of the examples, which is ident-io for the feature F. Now, F can be anything. It can be any feature that we can talk about voicing, it can about be nasal, it can be about any kind of feature. And then we have the max-io and the dep-io. Max-io is basically something that related to no deletion, that whatever segments are there in the input must also be in the output. And dep-io is about no epenthesis. Now, all the segments that are in the output must have an counterpart in the input or a correspondent in the input. So basically no epenthesis. Now, interaction of faithfulness and markedness constraints. In OT, the eval chooses the optimal candidate among the output forms based on the interaction of strictly ranked faithfulness and markedness constraints. Here we'll see this interaction or conflict through some case studies. Like, for example, we're going to take our final devoicing of obstruents in German, and second, the neutralization of lexical contrast, oral and nasal, in English. Now, for final devoicing in German, now you can see that the input form is Rat. Now that, and in the second example, then advice, you have Rates, and similarly in Rad becomes Rat, so there is devoicing of the to the, but in Rades it is still the, and in Tag would means day, Tag becomes Tak, but in day genitive it becomes Tages. So basically the G is devoicing to K, or the is devoicing to the. So now what happens is, basically in German there cannot be any voiced coda. Now if the coda is voiced, it has to change into a voiceless sound. For example, if the input is Rad, it has to change to Rat, or if it is Tag, then it has to change to Tag. But if it is not the coda, then doesn't matter, the voice can be retained. So the important constraint here has to be that there is no voiced coda, which is the markedness constraint, that there should not be any voiced coda, followed by, which is dominating the other constraint, which is the faithfulness constraint, that retains the voicing. It is a identity constraint that if there is voicing with the respect to the feature voice, that if there is voicing in the input, it must also be reflected in the output. So the ranking of the constraint is voiced coda is dominating identio. So the markedness constraint is dominating the faithfulness constraint. So for the input Rad, we have two candidates, potential candidates, Rad and Rat. But Rad is violating voiced coda, as the is there is the coda, which is voice. Since it's violating voiced coda, that becomes a fatal violation. And Rat is violating identio, which is a least serious violation, and therefore Rat is chosen as the optimal candidate. The second example, we are going to talk about the neutralization of lexical contrast. So in English, in some dialects at least, cat, we have cat, we have can't, we have bad, and we have banned. So in can't, the a vowel becomes nasalized, and for in a tautosyllabic nasal followed by a tautosyllabic nasal, it becomes nasalized. Similarly in band, it becomes nasalized when followed by a tautosyllabic nasal. Now oral vowels are nasal when they are followed by a tautosyllabic nasal and remain oral in all other contexts. They are not in complementary distribution and hence are allophones of the same phoneme. So we are going to posit two markedness constraints. One is that no nasal vowel, and second is that no oral vowel before a tautosyllabic nasal. The contextual markedness constraint dominates the context-free markedness constraint, dominates the faithfulness constraint. So let us look at the examples. Now we have as the input, we have two inputs. One is bad and the other one is banned. In bad, we have the same ranking of constraints in both the examples. So in bad, we have two candidates, potential candidates. One is bad and one is banned. In banned, there is a nasal vowel. Now this candidate B violates the no nasal vowel context-free markedness constraint, since it has a nasal vowel in it and there is no tautosyllabic nasal there. So it clearly violates no nasal vowel. And it also dominates identio nasal, because in the input the vowel was not nasalized vowel, it was not a nasal vowel. So since it becomes a nasal vowel, it's violating the faithfulness constraint as well. Whereas the first example bad incurs no violation at all, and hence the optimal candidate is A. In the second example, which is banned, we have two candidates. One is banned and one is banned with a nasal vowel. The first one, A, since it is a vowel followed by a tautosyllabic nasal, the vowel must be a nasalized vowel. Since it's an oral vowel, it violates the contextual markedness constraint, the first constraint, and that is a fatal violation. In the second one, we can see that there is no fatal violation. It has a nasal vowel, therefore the context-free markedness constraint is violated, and the identio nasal vowel nasal is also violated. Although we can see B has two violations, whereas one has just one violation, yet B is the optimal candidate. Why? because it incurs no serious violation. There is no fatal violations. It is not violating any higher ranked constraint. In this module, we discussed about the various constraints that are working in OT. Although constraints like markedness constraints and faithfulness constraints are not new concepts in phonology or in linguistics in general, but the constraint interaction based approach of OT forces us to classify these constraints into two types. Now we have seen the interaction of these constraints both internally and externally. Internally as in a markedness constraint conflicting with another markedness constraint or a faithfulness constraint conflicting with another faithfulness constraint, and also among them give rise to the most optimal candidate. As we have already discussed, the markedness constraint are the structural well-formedness constraint, while the faithfulness constraints check if there is any change in the output as compared to the input. The markedness constraint impose well-formedness of the output irrespective of what the input is. The interaction between these constraints give rise to our optimal candidate, and OT is all about these constraint interaction. I hope this was of help to you. Thank you.